I use the title the View from Shore because the record of the Franklin expedition on King William Island and Adelaide Peninsula is the primary source of the physical evidence that we currently have on which current interpretations of the what happened to the Franklin expedition are based. So in terms of historical context, the search for a route, a navigable route at least, through the between the Atlantic and Pacific Oceans through Arctic Canada has a very long history. And this map approximates the known Arctic as of 1845. So this map shows the gray area was unknown essentially as of 1845. And what it shows is the other areas that several hundred years of overland and naval expeditions had charted and mapped. So the reason for a search for a Northwest Passage, there is no single passage, is familiar to most people. There were commercial motives for it, the route to the Pacific and the markets there. There were scientific incentives as well, certainly magnetism, but also other sciences, botany, zoology, those sorts of things. And it presented a geographical challenge to countries mapping unknown areas of the Arctic, for example. And of course, bragging rights for whatever country happened to be able to accomplish a great deal of work in those areas. So by the 1840s, it seemed that all that was needed to be done was to link, you can see the open areas at the in the top with the navigable charted waters along the coast of North America. And they just need to connect those somehow. So, and there appeared to be a navigable route between southward trending east of Cape Walker. And it was about 600 kilometers to connect the two. But if they could do that, they knew that they could be able then to sail west and out via the Bering Strait. So in a renewed attempt in 1845, the Royal Navy decided to send a final expedition to try and accomplish this. John Franklin's orders were to head south at Cape Walker and find a way to the Arctic coast. If that wasn't possible, he was to head north through Wellington Channel. And if that wasn't possible, he was to transit whatever route he could find to get out of the Arctic. The ships were last seen on July 26th of 1845 by some whalers waiting to enter Lancaster Sound. As far as we know, the mission wasn't completed, or if it was, it wasn't completed. It wasn't accomplished as originally conceived. And Franklin didn't live to see it. And after 3 years with no word from the expedition, numerous search expeditions were sent out, several dozen almost. And these maps provide a sense of how much of the, how extensive the areas were that were searched. And what they revealed about the fate of the expedition has been a subject of interest to historians and to archaeologists and to the general public for nearly 170 years. The first major evidence was found in August of 1850 on Beachy Island and nearby locations, such as Cape Riley, but no further traces were found after that. And so in 1854, the Admiralty considered all of the men to have died and it planned no additional search effort. That same year, however, information and physical evidence related to the Franklin expedition were obtained from Inuit by John Ray. And the Inuit had found these items hundreds of miles south of where the main searches were being conducted. And the general area was around the mouth of the Back River, shown in the red circle, where Inuit reported finding these objects, some of which are seen on the illustration on the left-hand side. Now, searches hadn't been conducted in that area because it had been blocked by ice. And the thinking was, presumably, that they couldn't get down that in that direction. And so Franklin presumably couldn't either. 5 years later, through the efforts of Lady Franklin, a note was found in a cairn near Victory Point on the northwest coast of King William Island. And this note, very famous, was very important because it revealed the location of both ships and the desperate situation of the men as of April 1848. It also revealed, among other things, the blueprint for their escape plan. The escape plan was to try and reach the Back River and from there follow its course to an inland post, possibly Fort Resolution on Great Slave Lake. And this was going to be a journey of roughly 2,000 kilometers. This was a long trip. And equipment and supplies were put in boats that were man-hauled on heavy sleds. So this is going to be quite a journey. The evidence of the plan's failure was confirmed in discoveries of boats and bodies and artifacts or relics, as they were called at the time, along the route of their retreat on King William Island and the coasts of both sides of Simpson Strait on Adelaide Peninsula and the south shore of King William Island. So interest in why the expedition failed has been sustained in part, and certainly when measured by the loss of life, by its status as one of the darkest chapters of British polar exploration. It's also been sustained, I think, by environmental and human contexts in which it took place, by the apparent failure of state-of-the-art equipment, and the extensive preparations that were made and were intended to at least help mitigate the environmental obstacles. So the basic question is, how could this have all failed so spectacularly, particularly when other British polar expeditions encountered similar obstacles, including some loss of life, but nothing on the scale of what happened to the Franklin expedition. There's no shortage of theories about the causes that contributed to the disastrous outcome. Many focus on medical issues as a key factor. Scurvy and lead poisoning have been proposed, as have tuberculosis, botulism, and zinc deficiency. I think also that decisions that were made that unintentionally precipitated or worsened an already precarious situation, such as the route of the planned escape, might also have been critical factors. We still don't have a clear answer to many of these and other important questions, but it isn't due to a lack of effort. For their part, archaeologists have been searching for the last 40 years for evidence that might provide some important insights, and those efforts have made significant contributions. The latest major effort was launched in 2008 to try and identify the locations of the HMS Erebus and HMS Terror. Parks Canada assembled an interdisciplinary team of specialists from federal and territorial government agencies, crucially the Canadian Coast Guard and the Canadian Hydrographic Service, as well as Inuit and some private sector partners. The underwater archaeology team launched a coordinated multi-year effort to locate the wrecks, and they were using and continue to use historical, oral historical, archaeological and environmental data and remote sensing technologies. And these are just some of the people involved and some of the agencies involved. So I think a good place to start is at Cape Felix, among the sites that we've studied. It's the most northerly point on King William Island. It's about 25 kilometers from where the ships were beset in the ice in September 1846. Cape Felix was very likely the first place where they came ashore. And we know that they had established a base camp, I guess you could call it there. It was next to a freshwater pond and had good visibility in all directions. The camp was first discovered in 1859 by Lieutenant Hobson on the McClintock expedition. It contained a large stone cairn, three tent rings, one thought to be used by officers, several hearths, and a scatter of broken bottles and other materials. Because of the type and volume of material that was found at the site, I mean, there were tents, bedding, personal gear, equipment. Hobson thought that the camp had probably been abandoned rather hastily. We don't know why that would have been. We found several hundred artifacts at the site. They are typically very small items, broken glass, canvas. In the upper right, that is a wire cartridge for a shotgun. percussion caps, nails, and some pieces of clay pipes. A lot of material has been removed from this site over the years, including by some 19th century searchers. One of the interesting finds at the site is the a well-preserved lid from a can of Edwards preserved potato in very good shape. And we also found several artifacts related to firearms. I mentioned percussion caps, but we also found small pieces of lead, including a tiny splat of lead on a surface rock and 5 14-millimeter musket balls, 4 complete and 1 is partial. And as you can see, the complete examples have the sprues still attached where the excess lead that was poured into the mold. And it suggests that one of the activities at the site was casting lead shot. And the fifth specimen is only a partial, it's the bottom half. And my interpretation of that is that they ran out of lead. And so it only, when they finished that pour, there wasn't very much lead left in it. Moving further south, I'll speak for a few minutes about a site for which there's also a helpful historical description and a seemingly well-reasoned interpretation. And again, like Cape Felix, it had never been investigated until we rediscovered it in 2018. And this is where Schwatka had found 2 graves of members of the Franklin expedition, hence the name of the location. One of the sites contained a partial skeleton and the disturbed grave of an officer from the expedition who was thought to have died en route to the Back River. Schwatka found some isolated human bones and a very shallow and very superficially constructed grave with a cranium and a few other bones. And in the grave was a quantity of blue cloth and gilt buttons from an officer's uniform. Schwatka reburied the bones, and apparently he also left the cloth and the buttons in the grave, and he built a commemorative cairn over it. Here's an aerial shot of the circle, shows where the site is on a raised beach at south of Levascon Point. And on the right is what the feature looks like when we arrived. It's boulders and slabs. It doesn't have much integrity in the sense of being a grave. And one of the ways that we confirmed that it was the same feature that Schwatka had described was were 2 distinctive rocks for which there are counterparts and the sketch Schwatka built over it. So those 2 rocks shown in the bottom match almost identical to the Kluchak drawing. So that was interesting to find that. We found some surface remains, I think a tooth and a fibula, I think a broken fibula, and a human cranium and a mandible that were barely covered beneath 2 flat rocks. Excavation revealed a small number of other bones present, including ones that Schwatka had described. And the bones appeared to be carefully positioned by Schwatka, something he'd also done at the burial at Erebus Bay. We found a small number of artifacts, but they're very interesting. And none of these were found in the grave. They were found distributed around the feature. We found 10 gilt buttons of 3 different sizes from an officer's uniform, 2 shell buttons of the same type, the 4-hole buttons, the centers are broken out, and the side frames from an officer's sword belt, and a small iron buckle could have been for a leather strap or something. So there's no question about it being the same site that Schwatka had found, and there was no question about the rank of the individual who had been buried there. The last example I'll mention concerns a site in Douglas Bay. This is a map shows just showing you where Douglas Bay is on the south coast of King William Island, and about almost midway up the bay, about a third of the way up, there's a group of 3 small islands. And on the northernmost island, human remains were found in 1931. There's a large concentration of boulders on the high point of the island. You can see most of the rest of it's just sand. In 1931, Patty Gibson and William Skinner found 7 human skulls and an uninventoried number of postcranial elements on the island. They also found a few wood shavings and a few fragments of pine and oak wood. On this evidence, they concluded that the human remains were those of 7 members of the Franklin expedition. And this composite image has been used countless times in stories about the Franklin expedition and is probably familiar to you. They covered the bones in 1931 with rocks and erected a cairn over them. Here's a picture of William Skinner. 50 years later, Owen Beattie and James Savell visited the site to recover the remains for analysis, but they discovered that not only had the cairn been torn down, but that the bones had been all removed. To our knowledge, the site had not been reinvestigated since 1981, and we first visited it in 2014 to document it and to search for evidence that might clarify what to me seemed to be a questionable attribution to the Franklin expedition. We recorded several additional Inuit features at the site, but we didn't find any evidence to support the interpretation that this was a Franklin expedition site. By that, I mean, if seven men had died on this small island, we would expect to find archaeological evidence similar in type and or quantity to what has been found at other Franklin sites, including ones where far fewer men had died. Metal, clothing, buttons, glass, rope, et cetera. We expect to find those sorts of things at a site. We did find two human bones on the surface, however, a mandible and a partial pelvic bone. Both are quite old and weathered, and it's possible that they post-date 1981 or are much older and were overlooked in 1931 and again in 1981. We don't have details of exactly how extensive the surveys were. Or they could have been lost by whoever opened the cairn and removed the bone sometime during that 30-year interval between 1931 and 1981. If the remains that were buried in 1931 were available, the attribution of the site to the Franklin expedition could easily be answered through DNA analysis, but they're not. So this is a difficult site to interpret in my mind. No artifacts diagnostic of the Royal Navy have been found there. And to add to the confusion, the pelvic bone has been identified as female. So this raises the possibility, at least, that the remains Gibson found were Inuit. And unless some diagnostic new evidence is found, it's questionable whether, in my mind, whether this site has anything to do with the Franklin expedition. Nevertheless, I anticipate that we will continue to see that photograph in the media. So these are just some examples that I hope provide a sense of some of the sites that we've investigated and the approach that we take to trying to interpret them and understand them. We don't presume that our interpretations represent the final verdict about these sites, but we think they illustrate the importance of archaeological considerations when attempting to interpret the sites and the complexities of trying to balance evidence drawn from multiple sources. I mentioned earlier that I wanted to offer a different perspective about an aspect of the historic discovery in 2014 of HMS Erebus. We were, of course, thrilled to have played a part in the discovery by Parks Canada, which is sometimes portrayed as having been needlessly delayed as a result of a disregard for Inuit oral history about the wreck. The thinking being that it would otherwise have been found many, many years ago. So it's an interesting perspective. But in fact, for almost half a century, researchers had focused on Wilmot and Crampton Bay precisely because of the 19th century Inuit oral history about their discovery of a wreck there. So let's look at some information that offers a different assessment. There were two target areas in Wilmot and Crampton Bay were described in the 19th century Inuit testimony. Charles Francis Hall in 1869 understood it to be northeast of O'Reilly Island, without attaching a metric to it, if you will. He said it was a little ways northeast, or words to that effect, of O'Reilly Island. Frederick Schwatka, in 1879, based on his inquiries, he placed the wreck at about 5 miles west of Grant Point. It should be mentioned that none of the 19th or early 20th century investigations searched for the wreck site. They generally didn't have any means to do so. Most of them were done in the winter, so I'm not sure what they would have found there. But I think if anyone had looked for it, it would have been Charles Francis Hall if he had had the opportunity. But Hall's time on King William Island in the area was very brief. He wasn't able to stay very long. And I think we'd know a lot more about a few other sites as well, including Terror Bay, which is of interest to me, had Hall been able to spend more time. In any case, so what is the chronology of searches in Wilmot and Crampton Bay in recent decades? Well, we can start in 1967 as a centennial project. Military expeditions were sent into the Arctic under the auspices of Project Franklin to research the Franklin expedition, and that included diving off O'Reilly Island. They also went on King William Island to try and find Franklin's grave, and they also went to Starvation Cove. In 1997, 2001, or 2000, 2001, and 2002, David Woodman and others conducted side scan sonar and magnetometer surveys. And as you can see, their search areas match the two areas identified in Inuit oral history, which with David Woodman, you would certainly expect that. Here we see the areas where Parks Canada surveyed with side scan sonar between 2008 and 2014. And it's worth noting that the first year of the new project, the very first area searched by Parks Canada was Wilmot and Crampton Bay. Mr. Wilfrid Laurier was only in the area for any length of time in 2008 and again in 2014. So those were the years in which we had a chance to do serious surveying in the area. In 2008, we worked around O'Reilly Island. And in 2014, we systematically searched the islands in Wilmot and Crampton Bay from north to south. Some of these, particularly the northern end, had been previously examined by Margaret Petulli, I think it was in 1997. So if all these search areas are combined, and if you were to draw a border around them, they reveal an area of about 1,800 square kilometers that was repeatedly searched for 47 years before HMS Erebus was found. What happened in 2014 was that we found, we looked where others had not and found two artifacts, both of which were parts of a ship. These artifacts proved to be the key that would unlock the mystery of exactly where Inuit had found the wreck in the 19th century. Following our discoveries, Parks Canada shifted its search zone to where we had been working, and less than 24 hours later, they had found Erebus. And just as Inuit had told Hall, it was northeast of O'Reilly Island. In retrospect, if there was no Inuit oral history about the wreck, there's no reason why this amount of time or effort would otherwise have been spent, or directed at this specific search area, which is situated more than 200 kilometers from the last known location of the ships. So from my perspective, I think it's fair to say that the amount of time and effort devoted to searching in Wilmot and Crampton Bay and the results in 2014 can be seen as a compelling demonstration of the recognition by researchers of the validity of Inuit oral history and of its longstanding role and significant contributions to our understanding of the archaeology of the 1845 Franklin expedition. So I hope that this overview has provided a sense of the work that has been taking place on land since 2008 and the way in which we have approached the investigations. We're currently working on additional DNA tests on archaeological materials collected in the 19th century, as well as some new descendant data that we have, and we hope to have some results on that very soon. We've also completed work on stable isotope analysis, and we have a publication on that coming out any day now. And we're continuing to write up the results of other sites that we've worked on. I hope to get back into the field next year. The last two seasons have been canceled because of the pandemic. So I think, like my colleagues at Parks Canada, we're all anxious to get back. And I also want to highlight the fact that none of our work would have been possible were it not for the tremendous support and encouragement we continue to receive from so many individuals and agencies. So thank you very much.